thanks for coming. I really appreciate it.
Glad to be here.
Well, look, we're definitely going to go down a trip down memory lane, and you were my boss. You pretty much introduced me to this world of internal affairs, and I believe the first thing we should just kind of knock out is let's talk about this gavel here, because people are kind of probably wondering what this gavel is really all about, and for me, it's you gave it to me, and maybe we can give the,
this gavel's, it's a tradition at LAPD and Internal Affairs. There's a group of employees who get selected to perform the task of an associate advocate, and their role is to putting on, basically presenting cases in boards of rights, which is similar to like a court martial. And so they act as kind of the prosecutor in these boards of rights. And it's a really challenging job, and not a lot of people are capable of doing it or want to do it, but the people who do it, they take a lot of pride in it, and it's an important job. But for some reason, some time ago, it became a tradition that when they left, after they've done their tour as an associate, they got a gavel, and it's something that it's a token of appreciation and for serving that role. It really, in some ways, it's kind of silly because there's no gavel in the board, and right. If there was, it would be the chairman using it, wouldn't be associate advocate, but people who get these, they do cherish them. It's a token of the service that they provided when they were working as an associate advocate. I've got one.
Yes, you do. Yeah, you were an associate advocate, and that takes us here for the purpose of a trip down memory lane. That must have been what in your career? What years was that?
you mean like the dates of the years?
No, I mean you were there, 2007? I know you and I, you were my boss as a lieutenant. You were my boss in internal affairs in the advocate section I was there from 2011 to 2015. But when you were a sergeant, you did my job as an advocate.
So I had two tours at internal affairs. My first was as a sergeant. I was an investigator. I did criminal investigations for 2 years, and then I was recruited to become an advocate, associate advocate, and I did that for 2 years. So 4 years that's as a sergeant, Sergeant Two, we call it. And then I got another job, and I eventually made lieutenant, worked patrol as a lieutenant, worked as a lieutenant in a traffic division, and then I got a job back at Internal Affairs as lieutenant.
Perfect. And I like it. And we'll talk a little bit more about your CV, if you will. But before we get into that, of course, every guest gets the two episode questions. And question number one is on a scale of 1 to 10, right? 10 being the highest. Yeah. Please rate the importance of Internal Affairs in a police department and why.
Yeah, in my book, it's a solid 10. It's an essential role for a department to be held accountable. And it's something that protects, that, you know, some people have this perspective that it's internal affairs goes after officers. What internal affairs does is it protects officers from having to work, it protects good officers from having to work with officers who don't want to follow the rules or follow the law. And internal affairs is, it's the conscience of a police department. And so, you know, patrol is the main function. Patrol is always going to be primary. And everything else supports patrol, right? So detective function supports patrol. Traffic, juvenile, all these things support the primary service delivery patrol. And in my book, internal affairs supports patrol because we keep people who shouldn't be working out of the department.
Yeah. And at some point, perhaps there might be an alleged, you know, of a violation or a policy and procedure, or you probably failed to do something, and those are the things that we have to deal with in internal affairs.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, we've got to be able to take a look, and if somebody's out there doing the job wrong, it needs to be addressed, whether it's a training issue or a minor disciplinary issue, or if it's some really serious misconduct, intentional. Sometimes the department just needs to separate itself from people who aren't going to go along with doing things the way they should.
Correct. Okay, and question number two is, let me ask you, let me frame this in a way, because I know you and I, we're investigators in internal affairs, but what is your job? What is internal affairs' job as an IO, as an investigator? What do you think about that?
Well, so, you know, as an investigator, your job is really, it's an objective approach to just collecting all the available evidence regarding some allegations, right? So the allegations can come from the public or they can come internally from the department. But an investigator, really, you're going to go out and identify all the relevant reports, any relevant physical evidence. You're going to go canvas the scene of the alleged misconduct, if there is a scene, right? And identify any witnesses, interview them, get their statements, and put it all together in a package. So an investigator doesn't reach any conclusions, and an investigator doesn't summarize or in any way suggest which allegations should be found sustained or unsustained or unfounded. Investigator just puts it all together, and then it's going to go through an adjudication process, which is completely separate.
I like that. And before we leave this line of questioning, I also wanted to ask you about what's your opinion about civilian oversight? Because I know civilian oversight has been around even when you were a commanding officer in LAPD, but it seems as though that it's more prominent.
Yeah, I don't. You know what? It's complicated. But bottom line is, I don't like it. I think it's a scam. I think it's and this is based on my experience as an advocate and as associate advocate, and then running the advocate section. Civilian board members are more lenient on when it comes to disciplining police officers. They get the wool pulled over their eyes. They don't have the experience in police work, and so officers who are accused sometimes of serious misconduct can come in and, with their attorneys, tell a story that a command staff officer would see right through, right? And see, no, we don't do that. We're never trained that way. That excuse that you're coming up doesn't make any sense, and it would be unacceptable in the standard of the way we train and the way we operate. But some civilian members, they buy it. They buy these stories, and they're just more, I don't know, it's more compassionate or more lenient. They just tend to not be willing to hold officers accountable when, in my experience, they ought to. So, and I was frustrated with how much we could get sworn captains, sworn command staff to find officers guilty. Sometimes captains will even be like too lenient, but like civilians, they're way off the lenient end. So I don't think it helps the department. Yeah. I think it allows officers to remain to remain on the department who shouldn't be.
Okay, well, let's take a trip down memory lane. Look, what I do know is you are still an attorney, licensed, and I think at some point we kind of talked before this. What I didn't know is that you actually applied for the LAPD and you applied for law school at the same time.
I was fresh out of college. Actually, I was working for the city as a civilian, and I applied for LAPD, and I'd always wanted to be a police officer. But I also applied for law schools. And at the time, I got into law school first. It was really hard to get hired by LAPD at the time, given the hiring situation. And so I went to law school, and I loved it, but I didn't really love being a lawyer.
Any particular reason why?
You know, I was working in a law firm, and they were good to me, and it was a good law firm, but it's a grind. It's long hours, tedious hours, sometimes lonely hours, and there's not a lot of camaraderie and teamwork, at least at the time, you know, where I was working. I always had this itch, you know, that I wanted to be a police officer in uniform, and I really admired LAPD. And LAPD also at the time was going through a whole reform era that I wanted to be part of. So I pulled the pin and left being a police, a lawyer, and joined the police academy, and I loved it. I never regretted that decision, never looked back.
Which I ask a lot of my guests, did you get a letter? How did that happen? Did you get a letter, and what was that day when they said, you remember that day when you...
When I got into the police academy?
Yes.
God, dude, I don't... I don't remember if it was a phone call or a letter.
Didn't you have to stand in line at 4 you know what, like actually, 5 in the morning at Parker Center
I do remember now. It was a very short notice. You know, they had big classes at that time, and they're putting together these classes. And I don't know, it was a matter of just weeks that I had to, like, tell my boss I was leaving.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm joining LAPD. Yeah, and you show up in a suit, and they start yelling at you. And,
what was that like? The black line, and then what, running?
Oh, I loved it. It was, you know, if you don't, you got to understand that the yelling part, it's not, you can't take it serious. They're just trying to put you under some stress to see if you can operate under stress. Can you continue to listen to commands and operate and maintain your composure under stress, right? The physical part of it, I loved it. It was great. It was fun.
I got to tell you, same thing with me. And I'm a soccer dude. I played and I was completely in shape when I went in there. I wanted to show up a couple of my classmates, but every time we ran the PFQ, there was like 3 or 4 that were ahead of me. And yeah. I'm like, damn, you know what?
Yeah.
I know I can run it faster, but apparently there was a couple more. We actually had a pro athlete. For the lack of better words, he kind of breached his contract on a hardship, but he ended up being a great police officer. But yeah, those are times that certainly that we'll never forget. So after the academy, let's go. Where do we go?
So I got my first choice, and I worked 77th Division in South LA.
Oh, so you did the mothership.
Yeah, and I loved it. I mean, it was kind of rough at first. I had a training officer who really was just kind of angry at the world, and I was in the world. And that was challenging to get through that, but I did. There were some good people there who took care of me, and I learned a lot, and I liked it. Then I rolled out of there after my probationary period to Mid-City, to Wilshire Division.
Okay.
Did a couple of years there on a morning watch and in a SPU unit.
Mm-hmm.
And then I went back to 77th, which most people don't do. They don't go back to where they were a probationer, right? And people advise against it because they think, oh, well, they'll still think of you as a probationer.
Right.
But I didn't care. I wanted to go back. I liked working in South LA, and I did. And I also became a HITS instructor as kind of like a side gig, and I really enjoyed that firearms part of it. And then I made sergeant pretty early.
Really? Well, early in your career?
You know, it was about 4 years.
Wow.
Which, you know, part of it's timing because it's a 2-year hiring lapse. You know, if I had come on a month later, it'd have been another 2 years where I could make sergeant. Yeah. But
and the culture's like, what? I can't believe you made sergeant so young.
It is. You know, there's a weird thing on LAPD where some portion of LAPD, quite a bit of it, kind of like, they kind of view ambition as a character flaw, you know, which I never bought into, right? You know,
They frown upon stuff like that.
Yeah, like you can do 20 years the same, you know, same year over and over again, you know, or you can have 4 or 5 good years and learn a lot. And I would have enjoyed working patrol more, and that would have been fine with me, but I had this opportunity, and I always saw myself in a leadership role.
Yes.
So I had the opportunity, and I promoted as sergeant and got transferred to Pacific Division.
Okay.
And I loved being a field sergeant.
Yeah.
That was a great job.
It was. The beach.
Yeah. The beach. And, you know, yeah, and I was young, and I didn't have a lot of tenure. So there's definitely, when you promote early, there's definitely some of the officers are standoffish, right, about who's this guy, he's only got so many years on, and he's going to be a sergeant, he's going to tell me what to do. But as soon as, they're entitled to that to take, right?
Correct.
But you show up and you do a good job.
Yeah.
And you're there for them in the field.
Yeah.
And you're supportive and you know what you're talking about and you help them. Then they get over it. They see that you're going to be there to help give them some guidance. They get over that issue that they have and you just go on from that.
Did you at any point as you're moving in your career, did you tell them or did someone know that you were an attorney before you came on the job? And how did that roll out with the troops? Because, you know, and I asked for the purposes of, well, I should say reasons, not so much the purpose, but reasons is because you know how it is, the culture. Some people are not that educated. I mean, all you need is a high school diploma. to come on the job when you came out in 96 and I came out in 98. Yeah. But some people just, they really hone in on that.
Yeah, you know, I suppose that does happen. I just kind of ignored it, you know, okay. but you're right. But, you know, coming in with, you know, being an attorney and having a law degree, there are some people that kind of like, why are you here? You know, what are you doing? Are you
exactly?
You here to get us? Are you to, you know, why are you here? And kind of standoffish. But there's other people that see as, you know, you have something to offer, you know, yeah. and that's an asset. And that's what I paid attention to.
So be it.
Yeah.
It's the way it goes. And from sergeant, then you promoted to lieutenant, right?
Well, I rolled over to Harbor Division, and I worked as a gang sergeant there for a couple years.
Okay.
And that was a great job, but really taxing. And then I got an opportunity.
Let me stop you right there. Harbor PD. Then why do people...
People call it Harbor PD.
I call it Harbor PD because I'm from the Valley.
Yeah, so it's like Marvin's joking around here. It's Harbor. It's Harbor Division of LAPD, but it's if you look at the map, there's just it's way far away from the city of LA. There's this little strip of land that the city bought a long time ago to connect the Harbor Division, and so there is this kind of like culture down there that they're separate. Harbor PD, Harbor Division is separate from LAPD. Yeah. It really isn't, but. They sort of kind of think they think they're themselves.
Yeah.
Like so from there, I don't remember exactly what happened, but somehow I actually kind of got recruited.
Okay.
To internal affairs. I think I had done a couple of you do these preliminary investigations.
Yes.
That you get in the field as a supervisor, you get a
yes.
do a preliminary. Some citizen is accusing an officer of misconduct, right? Well, I would kind of jump on those and do like a really kind of thorough preliminary investigation.
Yes.
And it always, most often it serves the officers best because you're collecting a lot of evidence that's going to help show that, in most instances, it's going to show they did everything right,
yeah.
right? And it's going to help the adjudicator. And the officers, at first, they're like, why is this guy putting all this effort into this, yeah. this thing? Is he trying to get me? And then they realize, okay, I found a bunch of witnesses. They're going to... they were upstairs and they saw what happened and they saw that you didn't do what you're being accused of doing.
Correct.
Right? But you gotta get those witnesses and that evidence right when it happened.
Yep.
Right? And some of my investigations would go to IA and I'd get calls from the investigators got assigned and they're like, well, this case has already kind of been done. You did it. And so that's how I got kind of connected to internal affairs.
Wow. And here we are in IA. Internal affairs.
Yeah. So I got recruited or, I got assigned to criminal section South.
Okay.
South Crim.
Yeah.
So I did investigations there for a couple of years.
Good. And I know at some point, we promoted to lieutenant, and I know that we are going to talk about, before I forget, we are going to have two parts of this interview with Brian, because we really do have a lot to share that we feel you're definitely get some lessons learned and some takeaways. And I know as a sergeant, you were an advocate, you did work, you put on a lot of these border rights that we'll speak about, but you made lieutenant, and I know at some point you ended up coming back.
Yeah, you make lieutenant, and you left IA, went out to patrol for a couple years, and then traffic division for a couple years, and then I got a job back in internal affairs as a lieutenant, as the OIC of Admin Central, Administrative Cases and Central Bureau. And so I loved that job. It was great. I liked training investigators, mm-hmm. helping them do complete thorough investigations and helping them with the writing. I really enjoyed helping these guys and helping them with their careers and helping them, mentor them but I did that for a couple years, administrative investigations, and then I got offered the job to be the OIC of the advocate section. So
right.
the department
the officer
advocate.
In charge. You're the advocate.
The advocate. And that was kind of my dream job. It's kind of what I always wanted to do. To work with associate advocates or really top-notch sergeants and detectives who've taken on the responsibility of putting on cases. And so unlike an investigator whose job is just to collect the facts, collect the evidence, and put it in an investigation, advocates have the job of carrying the water for the department. They represent the department. They stand at a board of rights and they say, they, you know, this is the position of the department. And they argue a case before a board, and they argue that the evidence supports the charges, the counts, and that the officer should be found guilty, and then whatever whatever discipline imposed, sometimes termination. It's a tough job, and it's not a job that a lot of people want to do.
What do you think so?
Yeah, because you have a role in a process that could lead to a job, a police officer being terminated. And some people that, you know, understandably, they don't want to do that. They don't want to be involved in it. They know it should be done, but let somebody else do that, yeah. Right? But there are those who are willing to do it, and I always appreciated that. And, you know, and I am, the first time I was in a board, I was an OIC, an investigator, right? It was right. A case that I investigated. You get okay. called as a witness, right?
Yeah, you're the material witness.
Yeah, and so this officer got terminated. She had a DUI and she was driving at work. She's driving a patrol car around without a license, suspended license, and then she lied about it. And she ended up getting fired, really a lot because of her attitude about the whole thing. She wasn't going to go along with the program. But she got terminated, and then I remember some of my peers, investigators, they would say, oh, it's always a sad day when an officer gets terminated. It's, you know, and I was kind of like, well, I don't know. I think this officer needed to be terminated. You know, I think it would have been a sad day if the department had to keep an employee that had been so unprofessional and put so many people at risk and wasn't willing to accept responsibility.
Yeah. No accountability.
Yeah. So I didn't have that kind of problem. It's something that a lot of people have with being involved in the termination of an officer. Some of them need to be terminated.
Yeah, I think emotions get the best of you at times.
Some,
they can't help
yeah.
you.
So that's what the other part of the advocate job, the other part, and it's a really important part. Sometimes we get these cases that were investigated, presented to the chief of police. Chief of police hears about it, gets briefed, decides, okay, this officer needs to be terminated based on this investigation and how he was briefed. And then we get the case at the advocate section, and the advocate's job is to do some quality control on
yes.
that investigation. Before we put it on a board, we look at it and we go back and we talk to all those witnesses, and we put, you know, a set of fresh eyes on it. And sometimes we find things that just doesn't, it's not there. It's not there, whether it was, you know, the investigator just got sidetracked or got tunnel vision, or they missed something, or, you know, sometimes you'd get something and they got the rules wrong. They got the law wrong. They're accusing somebody of doing something that was illegal and didn't understand the law. So sometimes your role is to go back to the chief and say, chief, you recommended this officer go to a board of rights. Well, before we do that, I need to let you know that this is what we found
right.
in preparation. Yeah. And sometimes the chief will hear that and go, okay, let's re-adjudicate this case. And maybe it's not as serious. And that's also very satisfying. You know, you're getting a good result. And you're doing quality control now on internal affairs, right?
Yeah, and if I may intervene, you know what? I don't think many people understand the overall, you know, from the bird's eye view, the role
right.
that internal affairs plays. I know in the big machine that we both experience, I often say, because here's the problem: there's a stigma, and you know this. I mean,
yeah.
you've done this. It's been what, maybe close to probably 30 years, if that, 25 plus years, of what. We're considered to be the dark side.
Yeah.
We've been called evil.
Cop haters.
Cop haters,
yeah.
Blue Falcons.
Yeah. Desk jockeys.
Desk jockeys, that's a good one
yeah.
too. And what's interesting about why I wanted to do this particular platform with Internal Affairs is because, I mean, come on, man, we're 2023, and I believe that we should kind of like let the stigma kind of go away, because a lot of what happens is that they don't understand that a very poor quality investigation, you and Internal Affairs are going to go up to bat
yeah.
and say, hey, you know what? We don't have this. Preponderance is what? I understand it's 51%. I know in my experience, and maybe you can agree to this, but when we start talking about serious misconduct, like false statements, I know when I did a board, it's not 51, dude. They crank that up to yeah, like no, 80 because they want to make certain.
That's true. That you're absolutely right. The standard, the legal standard is preponderance, which is just, you know, it's more likely than not, right? But the reality is that when you're putting on a board, the members of the board that are deciding whether or not to fire an officer or impose discipline, they want to be sure. They want to be sure. And if they're not sure, they may find a way to find not guilty. Because in a board, you don't have a choice, an option of not resolved or we don't really know.
Exactly.
It's guilty or not guilty. Yeah, and I used to train captains on that because, you know, you get sometimes, you know, what you find is they're not going to find someone guilty unless they're sure. And what I would tell them is, you know, that's part of the job of being a captain, is you have to make decisions, and you have to make the best decision based on what you have, right? And yeah. you may want to be more sure, but sometimes you just have to make a decision and make it on the preponderance,
yeah.
right? And live with the fact that, you know, you could be wrong, but you have to make a decision on based on the evidence presented. And what do you think? You know, and you know, you always have to decide, you know, you're taking the interest of the employee and the department and the community. And
absolutely.
You have to consider all of those interests. And it's not always about, you can't just protect the officer.
Right.
You got to protect the department and the employee.
I know this was your duties and responsibilities as a lieutenant, and I know at some point you made command staff, right? You were a captain?
Yeah, yeah. I made captain and was assigned out to Harbor Division for a short period, and then transferred up to the Valley, worked in North Hollywood, right? And that was a good long trip for me.
Did you really enjoy the ride?
Yeah, it was a long commute for me. You try to work while you're driving. But I loved being a command staff officer. Loved working with the cops back again in that way. And you know, you have a lot of impact on their work environment, right? You know, if you're, you know, it goes a long way not being an asshole.
Yes,
right?
Absolutely.
It does. And being willing to sit down and explain to officers what's going on, why we're enforcing a new policy, or you know, if you are going to have to recommend discipline, that you actually bring them in and talk to them and explain them your thought process. Because then, you know, they at least know that, like, you gave it an effort to think right. about what you're doing. It's not yeah. just haphazard. And supporting officers in a lot of other ways. I did that for a couple of years, and then I got a job down at Legal Affairs Division.
Imagine that. To use your lawyerly skills to yeah. Start litigating and settling cases. What was that like?
That was a really interesting job because you're in on a lot of really important cases and policy issues. So what we do at LA at Legal Affairs is we assist the city attorney in defending the department when the department gets sued. The department gets sued by members of the public who we arrest or hurt, right? And then we also get sued by our own employees quite a bit.
Yeah.
And sometimes it turns out that we don't treat our employees right, and we end up having to settle those cases or go to trial and defend it. And sometimes the cases are nonsense. They're just some employees that don't want to take responsibility, and they've been through an internal affairs caper, and they want to sue to try to make some money. But those are really challenging cases, and it's really interesting, you know. And then a lot of the cases also, you end up realizing there's some policy issues, and so I had the opportunity to recommend some changes in some policies, some improvements.
Going back to your time as a commanding officer, as a captain in a patrol division, did you feel that discipline was one of the, I suppose, one of your, a lot of that you had to do in terms of your everyday job?
Yeah, I mean, way too much. It's a big part of the job.
Right. I mean, there's operational issues. I understand there's probably
personnel issues.
It's personnel issues. But when it comes to disciplines, was that something that really stood out a lot that you had to deal with?
It is. It's a big part. It's a big part of the job. Sometimes it's really heart-wrenching. You know, sometimes you have to, because you're going to start the ball rolling. You're the first one to recommend an adjudication. And you got to put a lot of thought into that. You know, you want it to be, you don't want it to go up the chain of command and be reviewed by people who think that you didn't think about this. And it's going to impact the officers. So you put an effort into it. You'd be surprised how much a commanding officer spends his time working on personnel issues, right? Whether it's discipline, but also there's also the personnel issue, like selection of, you know, there's a lot of promotions that happen and you get to select, you know, and yes. so you conduct interviews and select officers for positions within the division. But I don't know. I couldn't tell you what percentage of the time it is, but it's significant.
The other question I have is, during your time as a commanding officer or during your time in legal affairs, is there anything that sticks out, a highlight of a case, you know, without naming any names, or something that really, you know, as we sit here today, I know it's been a long time, you know, since then, that we can maybe perhaps get some takeaways or lessons learned that you can think of?
Yeah.
And the reason why I ask is perhaps there might be someone listening who is getting ready to promote to a command staff position, or maybe is a lieutenant who is dealing with all these personnel issues.
Yeah. I'll tell a story that I think command staff officers should know. We had a case came out of Southwest Division. It was an in-custody death. Right?
Okay.
So a male Hispanic, I think he was a gang member. He's rolling in a stolen car and he runs. He bails out of the car and he runs, right?
Okay.
He gets arrested without a use of force, you know, because he runs and then he gasses out and the officers, they arrest him. But in the field, he starts, I can't breathe. And he's in custody and I can't breathe. And there's a sergeant at scene. They put him in a car and a patrol unit is going to drive him to the station, drives him to the station and he's still, I can't breathe. They put him in a detention tank.
Okay.
And they leave him there and they go brief the
watch commander.
Mm-hmm. Sometime later, the watch commander comes back to the tank, opens the door, and here's a dead man.
Wow.
He's dead in custody. So then, you know, the investigation is like, what happened? Why did that happen? How did that happen?
Right.
You know, and it reveals, because, you know, we got all the body cam and in-car video,
okay,
that he was saying, I can't breathe at the scene. So sergeant's got some responsibility there. And sergeant took some discipline. On the roll from the short ride from the scene to the station,
yeah,
you know, I forget how many times I can't breathe, 27, 57, you know, he's just, and the officers are telling him, if you can talk, you can breathe, right? So they're wrong about that. And then the question is, so, yeah, they get interviewed right that day because of in-custody death, and, you know, FID.
He rolls out. Yes.
And asks them, yeah, so how was he when you brought him to the station? Oh, he was fine. Did he say he can't breathe? Well, maybe a couple times. Well, was he able to walk? Yeah, he could walk, you know. We held him a little bit of assistance, you know. That's their story. Right. Well, you know, there's cameras in the station, and you got an officer who saw them,
yeah,
take him out of the back of the car, and carry him from the car into the station. He's not touching the ground. I mean, they're holding him under the elbows and knees because he can't walk, right? And then they get him into the station and they basically drag him down the hallway. He's out. Drag him down the hall, and they put him in the detention center. Gently, right? But this all goes up to a board, right? For the failure to get medical care and then lying about it, right? And after the board, they find the officer's not guilty.
Wow.
Because they corrected their statement, right? They corrected their statement at the board. And I talked to the officer, the chairman of the board afterwards. So. Mm-hmm. What happened? How did we get this wrong? Because we really thought this case was a solid case.
Right.
For some neglected duty and for some false statements, right?
Right.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, you know what, Brian? We know what happened. You know, we know, you're right. We know what happened. But the department just didn't have the evidence. And I'm like, well, if you know what happened, how'd you know that? How'd you know what happened? It's probably the evidence that we present. I mean, how would you know?
Right.
You know? So you do know. You know, you just have to put it together. You have to make logical deductions and inferences and use your judgment. And, you know, some captains, they just don't want to go that way. It is emotionally, here's the takeaway. It's one thing to sit in a room by yourself or with a group of people and adjudicate a case, right? It's another thing to look an officer in the face and tell them, I find you guilty, and and you're going to lose your job and your career.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's an emotional hurdle that I think some captains are hesitant to take on.
Spot on. The only thing I can add to that is what I'd refer to is at times during this whole process, it's a little self-serving. You know, you think of yourself more than you do because of the emotions.
Yeah, yeah.
You think of yourself more than what you think about the actual process and the board in itself.
Yeah.
And that shouldn't be the case. You know, but
yeah,
it happens.
There's another case I'll tell you about.
Yeah.
Okay, this is a case that. Here's another one where some boards I really had a hard time, and they ended up terminating an officer. This officer, he was in a bunch of arguments with his wife, right? There was some infidelity on both sides, mm-hmm. and she had made a scene at a bar, and he had left her there, and she came home, and she had some prior attempts at suicide, and so she was telling him, and she was drunk, and she's telling him, I don't want to live anymore, and so forth. So he grabs his pistol and he puts it down right next to her. She picks it up and she kills herself, right? The only reason we know the story that I've told you is because that's what he reported happened. There's only two people in the room and one survived, right? So it happened in a small, outside the city. So another agency had the investigation and they investigated and they determined that they believed his story. The forensic evidence was consistent with his version of events. So he wasn't charged criminally, right? But we charged him with neglect of duty, failure to control your weapon, leading to the death of your wife, right? Which is serious, you know?
Yes.
It's a serious thing. You know, we get to carry these weapons and we have to handle them responsibly. And it's not a good idea to put one down right next to somebody who's talking about ending her life.
Correct.
So these captains, I mean, it was heartbreaking. The whole situation is heartbreaking.
Of course.
This woman died. Our officer is involved somehow in it, you know, however you want to read that situation. And he's got two teenage girls who no longer have a mother. And he's got to live with his role, whatever role he played in that. And now we're going to take his job away from him.
Yes.
Right? Heartbreaking.
That's gut-wrenching.
Heartbreaking. And the board, they did. They terminated him. And that's one of those situations where you have to look at the interests of the employee, the department, and the community. And in that instance, you know, this was not in the interest of the employee to fire him.
Right.
But department, you can't keep an employee who would handle a gun that way. You just can't. And he was and what's heartbreaking also was at work, great employee.
Wow.
Great employee. Big loss for the department. Yeah. But heartbreaking all the way around. And I know that those commanding officers who did that, it was hard on them emotionally to do.
Oh, I can only imagine, man. Brian, I know in part one, you shared with us a very devastating, just gut-wrenching, heartbreaking, you know, type of incident case that you were involved in. And I know as an advocate, because now we're going back in times when you were an associate advocate, sergeant putting on this case on behalf of the chief of police. Is there another one that just kind of sticks out? I mean, here we are 15-something years later that probably that you can share with us so we can get some lessons learned.
Yeah, I mean, probably one of the most impactful cases that I worked on that I personally presented to a board was a case involving a shooting death. It was an on-duty OIS. A 14-year-old male was driving a stolen vehicle in South LA, middle of the night. And officers pursued him. His name was Devin Brown.
Mm-hmm.
It was all over the newspaper, so I'm not like revealing anything that's confidential.
Right.
Devin Brown, he crashed his car into a sidewalk, right, at an intersection. The officers parked behind him, a couple car lengths, and he backed up towards the officers, right? Actually ended up crashing into the side of one of the police vehicles. But one of the officers, the passenger officer, stepped to the side of Devin Brown's vehicle and shot 10 rounds into Devin through the rear passenger door window and through the front open door. The front door of the Camry was open because the passenger had fled and left the window. So, yeah, the chief of police ended up adjudicating the shooting as out of policy.
Okay.
And directing him to a board. So it came to me to present it to a board. I felt it was a strong case because all the rounds did come from the side of the car. I felt like the officer was not in harm's way at the time that he was doing his shooting. And, 10 rounds is a good amount. And he also, the 10 rounds were, 7 of them were hits.
Okay.
So that's pretty hard to get if you're like really in fear for your life, running away, trying to get out of the way. 7 hits, most of them neck and headshots. To me, it seemed like a compelling case for a guilty. But one of the things that happened in the board, there's a lot of evidence, a lot of visual evidence, photos from the scene, reconstruction of the scene, reconstructed video of the scene. And all of this gives you kind of like a visual idea of what happened and how it happened, right?
Right.
But I had gone, in preparation for the board, I went out to the actual scene, to the intersection where this happened in South LA. I think it was like Western and 83rd or something like that.
And why would you do something like that?
You just want to be fully informed. You want to like really know what happened, and going to the scene and looking at it really can help you conceptualize what happened, right? And it was a really important case. It was all over the news. So I wanted to do the best job I could. But what happened is when I got to that scene and I looked at it, it was a different experience than looking at photographs or video.
Because this is all pre-body worn. This is like 17 years ago.
Right. Yeah, there was no body worn or no
digital in-car video, correct.
So what you had is, you had just photographs of the scene, right?
Right.
But when I was there, I'm like, yeah, it felt different. It felt smaller and it felt closer. And, even though I still felt it was an out-of-policy shooting,
right.
That feeling of the size and the location of the scene is impactful. And I thought it was important for the board to go to the scene themselves to make an informed decision. And so I recommended that they did. It's not something that we do often in boards, right? It's the only time I can remember it happening. But they agreed to, and the defense agreed to it. And they went and they viewed the actual scene. We actually sort of put together a quick reconstruction of the vehicles. And when they found him not guilty, the officer not guilty in this case, they wrote in their rationale that one of the most compelling aspects was their at-scene, visit, how it changed the way they perceived the incident and the distances involved in the incident, which is fair. I still thought it was out of policy shooting for all my right. reasons, but I did feel, and I knew going into that, to bringing them there, there's a chance it could lead them towards a not guilty. But to be fair, to make sure that they were informed as best as they could be right. before they made this important decision, I thought it was important that they do that.
Because it's not about Brian and it's not about Marlon.
No, it's not about me.
And that's part of the problem, I shouldn't say a problem, it's just part of the challenge of doing such a very important role in internal affairs. Let me ask you this. Did you feel that the defense was appreciative for you doing something like this? And what was your relationship like with the defense for the most part?
Yeah, so that case, it was
attorney that you probably...
He was an attorney, and he was a well-respected attorney. And, we have a professional relationship with the defense bar, the people who put these boards on, for the most part.
Right.
They're professionals, and they're going to go and argue on behalf of their client,
mm-hmm.
the accused employee, as best they can. I don't always agree with what they're saying, but they've got the right to say it. And I remember in this case, when I suggested this, they mm-hmm. were a bit, wary. Like, why did I want to do this? Because, they didn't think I'd be trying to help their employee,
Is that the... feel the vibe that they got from you?
For sure, right off the bat. But then they thought about it and they ended up supporting it, you know, because, right. you know, they probably went to the scene themselves. I don't know if they did, but
right.
for whatever reasons, they agreed to it. They didn't have any problem with it. They thought it would help. And I think it may have helped. The board in their decision said it helped them reach their decision.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Good. Look, anything else, that you can share in terms of these roles in internal affairs or the importance of internal affairs that you can kind of chime in on?
Did we want to talk about the adjudicative process?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, so, I used to train a lot on this, and a lot of people, I was really surprised when I worked on the department how many people knew so, they didn't realize how much effort went in to adjudicating a case, right?
Yeah.
So you get the case and it's investigated and there's investigation, goes out to the employee's CO, commanding officer,
yeah.
and they're gonna write what we call a letter of transmittal.
Right.
I don't know why they call it that, but it's a recommended adjudication, right?
Yeah. It's and like a rationale.
Yeah, they recommend that certain counts be sustained
or unfounded
or not resolved, and then they have to explain why in their written paper, right?
Absolutely.
So that would come to internal affairs, and it would get assigned to a lieutenant to review and then present. Every Monday morning, we have a meeting with all the lieutenants and the captains at internal affairs, and also somebody from our review and evaluation section.
Yes.
And somebody who's assigned a case, if you have sustained allegations, would brief the group. And you have the deputy chief, the head of IA there, and brief the group on the case. This is what the case is about. This is what the witnesses said. This is what the evidence is, and so forth. And this is what the recommendation is of the CO, right? And they're doing a group discussion. And sometimes it's like, that is wrong. That is just off. We're not going to do that.
Yeah.
You know, they didn't interview this person, or if a CO kind of like wants to give somebody, 6 months suspension for something that's really not a 6 month, we try to like make it consistent.
Correct.
Right? What do we, if accounts are sustained, what's normally the penalty for this, right? And the chief makes the final decision, right? Chief of IA, this is what we're going to do. We're going to recommend this and this, and these are sustained, these are not, this is the penalty from internal affairs. So then on Wednesday, a few members of that group, the ones who had sustained counts, goes to the chief's office, right? And briefs the chief.
Got to sell it.
And tells him, this is what we're recommending on this case, right? It was, this is what the case is about. This is what the captain, the CEO recommended. This is what internal affairs position is. And in that meeting, you've got the chief, you've got some assistant chiefs, you've got somebody from the city attorney's office, the chief's chief of staff.
Yeah.
And there's another discussion about what do we regularly do in this case? So it's what about that case? What about that case? Hey, what did we do, 10 years ago? And sometimes the chief says, look, I want more information. I want you to give me, more on this or that. But the chief has to make, there's a lot. So I'm just kind of, what I'm conveying is there's a lot of effort that goes in to make sure we get these things right when they're going to be sustaining account against the officers. In the end, the chief has to make the final decision, right, on where it's going to go, to a board, or the chief is going to sometimes, I've been there when the chief said, no, that's not misconduct.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I beg to ask about, do you prefer, you weren't a big machine like us.
Yeah.
Do you prefer a lots of levels of review, or what do you tell, or what can you recommend?
Well,
small agencies that barely even have.
See, the small agency, they have, it's a different level of efficiency because you've got, you've got a smaller agency, so the knowledge, everybody knows what's going on. Everybody knows what's happening.
Everybody knows.
Right? A lot of police departments, they're the size of one of our divisions, right?
Correct.
So they've got adjudication process that is more, I would expect, not as complex and not so many levels, but they don't need it. They don't need it because it's a smaller group of people, mm-hmm. right? So the information they have to work on, it's a smaller level. How many cases have they had?
Correct.
It's
sustained, pretty minimal.
Right? Well, if you got this, 9,000 officers in 23 divisions, and you're trying to make the the disciplinary system consistent, right?
Yeah.
You need these levels so that we're not you know, hammering one guy over here for this and giving us, you know, making it easy for somebody else who doesn't get disciplined for the same thing.
Which happens.
Right? It's going to happen anyways, but this whole effort is to try as best we can to make the discipline consistent.
Consistent.
And then, you know, of course, you're also looking into the employee's history, right?
Yes.
Right? So you can have one person who does this conduct here, but it's the fourth time they've done it.
Correct.
Right? So that's a different level of discipline than the guy over here who's done the same thing, but it's his first time.
Character and reputation does go a long way in the adjudication process.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I appreciate all that. Look, now we're in this segment. Let's really talk about what I always ask all my guests. I used to do best and worst, but I'm not going to do it because I don't want to leave on a worse note.
You don't want to leave on a worse.
I don't want to leave on a worse note. So let's go with worst. Worst incident and or, you know, situation in your police career that you can think of.
So, you know, I'm just like so many police officers, the worst things you see involve kids, right? And the one incident that just stuck with me and broke my heart for so many years was a murder-suicide that I responded to. And I was a lieutenant in the Valley.
Uh-huh.
And this man was the father of three young kids. And he shot his wife, killed her, and then he shot himself. And in the next room were his three young kids, ages like 5, 7, and 9. And when I arrived, he wasn't dead yet. He was still gurgling. And the kids were there. And we had to comfort the kids the best we can and get them out of the scene. And I, along with a detective, a female detective, I drove them from that scene, from their home, to the station, where I knew they'd be meeting with a social worker and then another family member who was on the way. But just knowing that those kids, that they're never going home, they're never seeing their mom or their dad again. And I had kids of my own, you know? And
I still
remember that. And the older one, look in his eye, he was just like comatose. And the younger ones, they don't really get it.
No.
So that's, unfortunately, kind of a common experience for a lot of law enforcement, having to see that kind of a thing.
Yeah, and you know what, and time after time, and you work the streets more, it creates trauma. And I know back in our days, we didn't have the resources that we do today. I mean, today you have these firms, you have these companies that actually hire retired police officers to deal, you know, it's kind of like a life coach, but in law enforcement to deal with these type of issues because it's very prominent. I think mental wellness has risen in terms of awareness, and I'm all for that. And I thank our law enforcement community for doing that. So now let's get to the good part. Let's see best, whether it was funny, great, something that, you know, that sticks out.
Wow. Wow. I mean,
it could be a radio call or something you achieved.
Yeah. You know, the most satisfying thing, you know, as a leader, right, on the police department, is when employees reach out to you and thank you for what you did for them. You know, whether it was just supporting them in a tough time, or, you know, the people that you choose to promote, or, you know, mentoring people. There were people who, you know, I would take an interest in because you see some talent.
Yeah.
And there were employees that, you know, when I retire, actually, and really what it comes down to is when I retired, there are a number of employees that I hadn't worked with for years, but I had mentored them along the way or supported them in one way or another, that reached out to me and thanked me for how I impacted their career or their work environment. That's the most satisfying thing for me, is hearing those personal communications of thanks for something I did for somebody. That's really gratifying. That's more gratifying than like winning a case or anything else.
Yeah, no, totally.
Knowing that you impacted somebody in a positive way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So I'll leave the floor to you. Is there anything that you can tell a young police officer trying to come on the job, or you know, someone who's promoting, someone who wants to make command staff? I mean,
You know what? This is what I will say.
Or about police work in general.
It's a great time to be a police officer. It's a great time to be in police work, and it always has been, and it always will be. When I joined the police department, it was right after the Rampart scandal. And you hear all these naysayers. Oh, it's a terrible time to be a police officer. The public trust, blah, blah, blah. It's always that way, right? We go from one scandal or crisis to another. You know, Rampart scandal, Rodney King, the summer of protests and social justice
and the George Floyd case.
So, and all that's true and all that happened, and those are all challenges for police leaders and police officers. But look, if you want to join a police department and put on a uniform and go out and treat people well, treat people with respect, and serve the community with a good attitude, you will always be appreciated and loved for doing that. I mean, and just forget about all the other stuff, right?
Yeah.
Just if you do your job well and you are a source, if you can go to a scene and try to restore order for people and provide some level of assistance to you, people who are in crisis, right? That's what people need. And they will appreciate that when police officers do that to them. And the reality is police officers do that every day, all the time. And that's why good people are still becoming police officers.
Yes.
And are still finding the career rewarding. Mm-hmm. And I say this because I think there's a lot of people who would be great police officers and who miss out on that career because they hear all this negative stuff.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
It's a great job. Your job is to go out and help people, and sometimes put bad guys in jail. Right? You're going to do that too, and that feels good too.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. Well, thanks, brother. Look, I'll leave with this. You're too humble to admit or to even say anything, but when it comes to, as we went down memory lane, a trip down memory lane in your career, you did mention that you wanted to take on the leadership role. For me, you were a great leader. I don't just say that loosely, only because I've had a lot of bosses. I have. I've gone through a lot of different assignments in my 24 years in LAPD, and I learned a lot. You really taught me a lot. Look at us now. You know,
yeah.
This goes back 10, maybe even 12 years, and we still talk, and you were... what I liked a lot about your style is you were very... you were the buy-in guy. What tripped me out is you were an advocate. You did put on border rights, these hearings.
Yeah.
And then you come back as a lieutenant, and here I am working on these cases. And one of the things that sticks out to this very day is you tell me, hey, you know, come in my office and let's talk about this case. How would you handle, or what do you think about this? As opposed to, and the whole time I'm sitting there going, well, shit, dude, you did the job. You should kind of know. And to have that ability to offer, to motivate me to learn, even though you might know the answer or even though you have an idea how to approach I can't thank you enough. That's a style that many, I can tell you from just my experiences that we don't have. And I did that a lot when I became a sergeant. I was out in the field with my guys, my last stop at transit. Even though I was a complaint coordinator, I've been doing this job so well, I always took the time to say, you know what, how do you think you will handle something like this? Even though I have an idea.
Yeah.
But you know what, it never hurts to, because it's never really about you. And I appreciate that. And on that note, hey, thanks for coming. I know that you and I can talk cases.
Oh, yeah. And I enjoyed working with you, Marlon.
Thank you.
You were a really passionate employee. Always brought life. Always brought life to the case, right?
If that gavel, my understanding in the gavel, you had to engrave something that stood out
from
that individual,
that's right? That's right. And yours?
That's what it says.
It says.
Let's just zoom it in on if you can. We will. It says, that's my time as an advocate. And it says right here, it says, give it life.
Give it life. Right. That was your saying.
That was my saying. You know what? Let's put it on and
from there on, you know, just give it life when we do our opening arguments, and I appreciate that. For those out there, please don't forget to subscribe. Certainly push the like button. Watch this episode and all other episodes. And at the very least, don't forget to share as well. And we thank you for listening to all this. And like I always say, please be safe out there and don't forget to go Code 6.